Yeah, welcome back. So today now we will continue our discussion with on complex impedances. So we will discuss today. We have some idea of phasors now, and now the next thing is to develop the notion of impedance in the circuit. So let's take a RLC circuit. A series RLC circuit, and what I have here is I connect it to a voltage source which is some Vm sin omega t plus phi, and I will assume that sine of omega t is the reference phasor. So the point that I am trying to say is that usually you can directly figure out which is the reference phasor by looking at with what the angle has been defined. So in this case, if I write everything as sin omega t plus phi, then usually sin is a reference phasor. If everywhere I write it in the notation Vm cos of omega t plus phi, then Vm equal, then cos omega t would be a good reference phasor. And if some are in sine and some are in cosine, then you are free to choose one and be consistent with that. Again, a point that I want to mention to you is that we are looking at a steady state performance of the this thing circuits. So the equation that I am going to write here for this is the equation that this particular circuit has. Now the question is, what simplifications can I do for sinusoidal analysis? And again, when I say sinusoidal analysis, I mean to say that there is only one frequency, the sources are not of multiple frequency, the sources are of only one frequency. And the thing that we want to show now is that this in fact can be converted, this different integral differential equation can be converted to a simple algebraic equation. This is the main thing that I want to drive. So let's say that this is the current I which is flowing through this loop, and therefore this is our equation here. So the VR is R times of I, and the VL is L di by dt, and the VC is 1 by C integral I dt. So these are the three elements which are connected in series, and the Vm sin of omega t plus phi is equal to Vr of t plus Vl of t plus of Vc of. Okay. Last class, I don't remember if I did the d by dt of the complex exponential. So let's start with the d by dt of the complex exponential. What is the differential of it? And that is, I can write it as cos of omega t plus j times of sine of omega t, where recall that j in our power engineering is the under root of minus 1, which can therefore be written as omega minus of sine of ओमेगा माइनस ऑफ साइन ऑफ ओमेगा टी प्लस जे कॉस ऑफ ओमेगा टी विच इज टेकिंग जे कॉमन आउट इज कॉस ऑफ ओमेगा टी माइनस वन इज जे स्क्वायर सो देयरफॉर जे साइन ऑफ ओमेगा टी विच इज जे ओमेगा टाइम्स ई टू द पावर जे ओमेगा ऑफ टी. So the interesting thing that lesson that I want to draw from here is that sometimes you will find that this is written also as a p operator. D by dt is also shown as a p operator, and the derivative of for sinusoidal analysis, a rule of thumb that we can make is that for sinusoidal analysis, or rather complex exponentials, for the time being let me use the phrase for complex exponentials based analysis, we can replace p which is d by dt by g of omega. So in other words, what we have shown here is that p of j omega of dt is equal to j omega e to the power j omega dt, which is equivalent to notationally saying that p can be replaced, the operator p can be replaced by j omega. And this you would find being done in many courses like signal systems or power engineering and means machines and power systems. Many places transient analysis you would find this kind of substitution being done. This is also called as a Heaviside operator. All right. Now, if you look at the integral of e to the power j omega dt, then reciprocally it will come out to be 1 by j omega e to the power j omega dt. Why? Because if you differentiate this, then the j omega will come out as common and cancel with this, and you will be left with e to the power j omega t, which is what you are integrating. So it is very obvious the reciprocal operation is of the differential is the integral operation, and this integral of e to the power j omega t dt is 1 by j omega e to the power j omega of t. Okay, I think maybe a good idea to box it up also. Okay, and we will box this up also. So what we did is this box is moving. D by dt of e to the power j omega t is this, and this is this. Good. Now again let's come back to that first equation that I had taken here, and let me just copy it and bring it down for our further work. So let's say this is my differential equation, why do I call it as an integral differential equation, because there is a differential also on it and there is an integration also in it, but of course you do one more derivative and then it will become a second order differential equation, in which the source also will be written as dv by dt. So it will be expressed in that form, and to if you recall, to solve it completely, you need two initial conditions. But as far as steady state condition is concerned, we are going to show that something simpler can be done, and that's the main thing that we are focusing on right now, which is steady state this thing. Now, typically, our source, as I wrote, it was could be either Vm cos omega t plus phi or Vm sin omega t plus phi. And we want to find out the response I of t. So our question is this. This is what is the I of t. And by now, we have a clear notion of what we expect. We expect it to be the response I of t to be some either, we expect either the response to be sine of omega t plus say phi dash since I wrote the cos first, so this or sine omega t plus phi dash. But we'll see, we have to derive that now. This is something that we have to derive it, and we'll see what we do. A thing that usually we do is we directly do a trick that we usually do when doing sinusoidal analysis is that we don't directly attack the sinusoidal forms. Rather, we first do an analysis with complex exponential and then specialize it for sinusoidals. Why would that kind of a thing work out? Because cos of omega t plus phi is the real part of e to the power j omega t plus phi, and sine of omega t plus phi is the imaginary part of e to the power j omega t. So therefore, the idea is that if you do analysis with this and complex exponential this, and if you wanted to find the response actually for the cos omega t plus phi excitation, then just look at the real part of the response, and that should the real part of the response would be the response corresponding to the cosine excitation. And if you want to see the response with respect to the sine omega t plus phi, then just look at the imaginary part of the response. So this is the simple idea that we are using when dealing with phasors or sinusoidal circuits with constant R, L and C, which are basically linear circuits. So the life is very simple. So complex exponential response is a superposition of the response to cos of omega t plus phi and sine of omega t plus phi. So in other words, suppose IC of t was the response to the excitation of cos of omega t plus phi, or even if you say V1 of cos of omega 2 plus phi, and if IS of t is the response to an excitation of IS Vm sine of omega t plus phi, then e to the power j omega t plus phi, like this, the response would be IC of t plus j times of IS of t. So superposition is a valid for linear circuits. This is essentially application of what is known as a superposition theorem, and that's a valid concept for linear circuits. So you if the if the excitation is, which is the source function Vm sine of omega t. So suppose you scale it, scale the excitation, you scale the response. If you have two responses to two individual excitations, and then the excitations are joined or superposed, combined or added, then the response also will be the simple addition of the individual responses. So all that is possible with this simple constant RLC value circuits, and that's the theme that we are doing. So what I am going to now do is, for this circuit here, I am going to assume that this excitation is Vm e to the power j omega t, j omega t plus phi. Okay, so let me write it down here. The excitation function is taken now to be Vm e to the power j omega t plus phi, and this is also represented by a phasor or a vector Vm angle phi. So this is Vm cos of phi plus, in rectangular coordinates, Vm j of phi, which is also same as writing it as Vm e to the power j of phi. Now this is the excitation function that I have taken, let us say, and my question is, this is a complex sinusoid excitation function. Real life doesn't have complex sinusoid excitations. This is only for the purpose of analysis. And the question now is, what is I of t? So let me hypothesize that I of t is Im e to the power j omega t plus some phi dash. Now this is also unknown. These two numbers are unknown, but in other words, the current could be written by a phasor Im angle phi dash, which is Im e to the power j phi dash, which is Im cos of phi dash plus j sine of phi dash. Let me say that I can write, I hypothesize that the response will be also, the current response will also be a complex exponential with a different amplitude Im and a different phase angle phi dash. Now let's see if this works out or not. So let's check it out. So our equation, what was our equation was R plus LDI by DT plus 1 by C integral I dt is equal to V of t. This was the basic equation that I had and now I am going to substitute this for I, and when I take the derivative, then I will take j omega common out here and bring it out there, and when I am taking integral, I'll take 1 by j omega and write it. So what I mean to say is, to be slightly precise, if I look at this can be written as d by dt of e to the power j omega t times j of phi dash, but j of e to the power j of phi dash is a constant, so I can take the constant out. You should check it out, expand it and check it out once. You know, all these derivatives with complex algebra, you should do it once all through and then later on just reuse it. But I'm not doing it right now. I'm leaving it to you to check it out, that this is how I can do it, which will then come out to be this. We have already derived it to be j omega will come out, and then this will be e to the power j omega t, which is nothing but j omega times e to the power j omega t plus of phi dash. All right, so let's let's keep this separately here. And if this is what happens with differentiation, the integration being the reverse operation, 1 by j omega is all that you expect to come down and everything else should remain the same. So now, therefore, I can now write, if I have assumed that the response is going to be a complex exponential, then I can write it as r e to the power j omega t plus phi dash plus j omega l e to the power j omega t plus of phi dash plus 1 by j omega c e to the power j omega t plus phi dash will be equal to Vm of e to the power j omega t plus of phi. Is it not? And now I can take Im times e to the power Im times e to the power j omega t as common. So I have missed out the Im term here and Im term here. So I will take that out as this terms as common, and therefore I will get this as r plus j omega l plus 1 by j omega c times of Im e to the power j omega t plus phi dash, which I am going to write, split it and write it like this, is equal to Vm e to the power j omega t times, again split it and write it as e to the power j of phi. So now I can cancel this term and this term. So these two terms I can cancel them out, and therefore what do I get? I get that Im e to the power j phi dash, Im e to the power j phi dash is equal to Em v to the power j phi divided by r plus j omega l plus 1 by j omega c, which is like saying that the complex number, a vector and a complex number have been equivalent. So this can be treated as the phasor V bar divided by R plus J omega L plus 1 by J omega C is equal to, this can be equivalent to the phasor I bar Im J omega phi, and this is the response that I am getting. So yes, what is the conclusion? If the complex exponential function is taken as the excitation function, the response is also for a linear circuit consisting of series RLC, the response is also going to be a complex exponential function for current with different amplitude and phase angle, which can be calculated by the division of V by what is known as complex impedance. So this term R plus j omega L plus 1 by j omega C is what is called as the complex impedance Z, which can also be written as R plus j omega taken out common. J taken out common. This can also be written as R plus J omega L minus 1 by omega C. That is, multiplying this term here by J in the numerator and denominator, and then substituting for J square as minus of 1. And then you get this term. Why is it called complex impedance? Complex is very clear because it is a complex number. So because it is a complex number, it is called complex impedance. Complex is very clear. Impedance why? Because it is something like resistance. It impedes or puts opposition to the current. If there was no opposition, the current would be infinite. But because it puts a opposition to it, the current becomes a finite quantity, just like resistance. Hence, the resistance is also resistance and impedance are synonymous terms, and that's why this is called as a complex impedance. And because complex numbers are shown by z, small z typically, this complex impedance, we borrow that notation and show it as z. It's easy to see that its unit is going to be ohms. You can easily verify that, putting all the dimensions appropriately, that unit of this is ohms. So now, if the excitation function is Vm cos of omega t plus phi, okay, then what is going to be the response, response it? It is going to be Em cos of omega t plus phi dash, because this is the IC part that I told you earlier, where Im e to the power j phi dash is nothing but V e to the power j phi by z. So once you have done this much part, your job is done. You can quickly translate this algebraic number, so to say, into or phasor numbers, algebraic numbers or phasor numbers into a time domain response. Is it not? You can quickly translate this into time domain response. And what if Vt was Vm sine of omega t plus phi? Then your response would have been Im sine of omega t plus phi dash, where the calculation of Im and phi dash is still remains the same. So we have reached a very, very important and nice point about solving this thing, a series RLC circuit, which is a sinusoidal response of the series RLC circuit, which can be very compactly presented as that you can just write V bar. If the excitation function is V bar, then this, if the phasor is V bar, then the current response will be I bar, will be simply V bar is I bar is simply going to be V bar by Z. So this is nothing but the this is nothing but what is this? This is nothing but the Ohm's law, is it not? The Ohm's law with the phasors. With resistive circuits, you had I equal to V by R. In this case, you have with phasors, these are all complex numbers, yet the dimension is going to be amperes, because the dimension of Z is ohms, the dimension of V bar is volts, and therefore the dimension of I bar is going to be amperes. Now let's take a parallel RLC circuit. Let's do this thing, same thing with the, let's extend this concept to parallel RLC circuit. Okay. R L C and this is a current source, so I will show vertical arrow like this to indicate that this is a current source, and let's say that this is Im cos of omega t plus phi, and we want to find this given this is as R, L and C. So now writing KCL, there is only one node here of interest, and we can write the KCL here, which is to say that this current is the summation of this current plus this current plus this current. And this is also called as nodal analysis. The previous when we looked wrote the voltage equations across the loop is also called as mesh analysis. So we are going to get I of t, or I will write it like resistive current is V by R, inductive current is 1 by L integral V dt, and capacitive current is C dV by dt. This should be equal to the input current I of t. This should be equal to the input current I of t. Now, if I of t is, again following the same lines, taken to be a complex exponential like this, very clear now that Vt will be also a complex exponential, because it's an integral differential equation, very analogous to the previous one, except that the state variable is voltage here, and the with the integral term earlier we had 1 by C, now we have 1 by L, and for differential term earlier it was L di by dt, it is now C dv by dt. But basically otherwise maths wise there is nothing different here. So we can, so the type of the response and everything else is going to be the same, and I can write this therefore response as this plus Vm, Vt will be equal to Vm e to the power j omega t plus phi dash. Now substitute it up there. So what you will get, 1 by R plus, whenever I see an integral, I have to substitute 1 by j omega. So I will get 1 by j omega L, and wherever I see the P operator d by dt, what should I substitute? J omega. So j omega C into Vm e to the power j omega t, again splitting it in e times of j phi dash, should be equal to Im e to the power j phi into e to the power j omega t. And then again we can cancel this and this, and so we can write now that 1 by R plus 1 by j omega L plus j omega times Vm e to the power j phi dash is equal to Im e to the power j phi. And then this here is the voltage phasor, this here is the current phasor. So therefore we can write that I'll also add one more thing. This voltage 1 by R, 1 by j omega L and j omega C. So each of these terms here is of the reciprocal nature of this. What we are adding here in the parallel circuit, what we are adding is reciprocal of R, reciprocal of j omega L and reciprocal of j omega C. So therefore this term, the reciprocal of this term, so therefore the dimensionally everything is all reciprocal terms have been added. So dimensionally also this is going to be of dimension 1 by z, which is called as admittance also, and this is 1 by j omega L plus 1 by j omega c. Its unit is 1 by ohm, also Siemens, also called as mho, which is the ohm spelled backward. And this is known as the admittance of the circuit. So 1 by z admittance also has a notation y. I mean, just because z has been taken, so you can't go beyond z, right? So you go just one letter back and it becomes y. And we get that y times of v bar is equal to I bar, which is nothing but, or actually philosophically, it's the same thing here, but 1 by z is written as y bar. So this comes out to be the parallel, for the parallel combination of RLC. So the what is the lesson that we have learned for parallel RLC circuit? For parallel RLC circuit, we have learned the lesson that just like with parallel resistive circuits, where we took the reciprocal of the resistances and added them in parallel. Similarly, here in parallel RLC circuits, we take the reactances and the resistances, reciprocal of them, and add them in parallel. And then what we get here is the what we get here is the corresponding complex admittance. So if you look at it, actually we have now got a very similar or analogous part of your Ohm's law for resistive circuits. Now we have the Ohm's law for RLC circuits, and the rule is for series RLC circuits, add resistances and reactances in series when they are in series. For parallel RLC circuits, add reciprocal in series, reciprocal of the three, of the reciprocal of R j omega L and 1 by j omega C, because the capacitive reactance is 1 by j omega C, series inductive reactance is j omega L, and the resistance is R. So add the reciprocal of this and obtain the corresponding reciprocal of the net impedance, which is called as the admittance. And so you can practically handle all the series parallel circuits. And wherever you get this, in general, while doing this P operator for sinusoidal analysis, you can replace it by the term j omega. And so if you have an integral operator, you should replace it by 1 by j omega, when only one frequency is in the play. So these are some very nice simple things. Now we are practically able to, we have extended our theory, and we are practically in a position to handle both the series parallel circuits, and therefore combinations of them also. There is nothing, no big deal about it, just like any other network law. Now one more thing that we need to look at before we close this lecture is phasors and transformers. So let me start with an ideal transformer. And if you recall, the primary turns ratio, primary this is an ideal transformer, and if it has N1 to N2 turns, and this is, let's say, V1 of T, and let me now show by a box some RLC load is there, which is shown as Z, and this is V2 of T, this is I1 of T, and this is I2 of T. So earlier itself I have shown to you that V1 by V2 is equal to N1 by N2, and I1 by I2 is equal to N2 by N1. Have I not shown you this earlier? Now what I am saying is, with sinusoidal voltage excitation on the primary, you could use instead the phasors and write that V1 bar by V2 bar is equal to N1 bar by N2 bar, and I1 bar by I2 bar should be equal to N2 by N1. Why do I say that? Because if this is my primary excitation, then the corresponding phasor is e to the power j of phi. This is the V1 bar, and now what is the response? V2, this is V1 of T. Now what is V2 of T? V2 of T is N2 by N1. So V1 by V2 is going to be N2 by N1. Come back to this equation. So V2 is here, N2 by N1 of V1. So therefore N2 by N1 of Vm sine of omega t plus phi, which if written as phasor would be V2 times of N2 by N1 Vm e to the power j of phi. But then what is Vm e to the power j of phi? V1 bar. So therefore we get that V1 bar by V2 bar is equal to N1 by N2. And in the same logic, following the same logic, you get the reciprocal equation for N2 by N1. Exactly same argument has to be made, and you get this thing. So earlier we had said, when we were in time domain and we were talking about ideal transformer, we had said that the current scale in inverse proportion to the turns ratio, and voltage scale in proportion to the number of turns. So the same is also true with phasor. So you can also say that if the ratio of the turns is N1 to N2, then the primary phasor voltage and secondary phasor voltage will have a ratio of N1 to N2, and the reciprocal will be applicable for the phasor currents. So you can see now that everything is getting nicely mapped into the phasor domain. That's something very good about what we are doing, that everything is nicely getting mapped into the phasor domain. One more interesting thing with transformers is that, let's say this same transformer only, N1 is to N2. This was, now I can show the phasor, the sinusoidal voltages as phasors itself, N1, N2, and a complex impedance Z. The voltage here is V2, the voltage here is V2, and the current here is I2, the current here is I1. So then, if you look at V1 by I1 bar, that is equal to, and let's call this turns ratio N1 by N2, let's use a notation A for it, then this is A times of V2 bar, and I1 is 1 by A times of I2 bar. So therefore this becomes A square times of V2 bar by I2 bar. But V2 bar by I2 bar is how much? Is actually here is it is Z. So therefore V1 bar by I1 bar becomes equal to A times of Z, unit being ohms. So this is interpreted as follows, that the impedance seen from the primary side, is scaled up. Just for the sake of discussion, I am saying assuming A to be greater than 1, but it need not be, it could be less than 1. It's scaled by the square of the square of the turns ratio. So for example, let's say that the secondary load or impedance was 1 ohm and the turns ratio was 10, then the primary impedance seen would be 10 square times of 1, which is 100 ohms. If Z2 was, let's say, 3 plus J5 ohms, which indicates an inductive circuit because capacitance is 1 by J omega C, which would come with a minus J sign. So this is an indication of this positive term plus J5 is an indication of this is an indication of an inductive circuit. Then Z1 would be 100 times 3 plus J5, which would come out to be 300 plus J500 of ohms. So this is also written as sometimes as Z2 dash, which is to say that impedance of secondary referred to primary. This dash here indicates that it has been referred to the primary. Now, of course, this is analytically itself, it is important concept to do and use, but this is one of the applications of this is what is known as impedance matching. And this is required to apply one place where you want to do this is when you are trying to do maximum power transfer from primary side to the secondary side, where we want the Thevenin's impedance to be complex conjugate of the load impedance. I'm not going to develop this more. Or second thing is like when you have this earlier, if you recall, you used to have these TVs and all that, you know, so you had an antenna and then the TV from the antenna cable came and plugged into your TV, and there to get the correct fidelity of it, you had to terminate it into a characteristic impedance. You would learn these concepts future on. So the characteristic of the impedance of the cable or the line is already known. The actual impedance is different. So you place matching characteristic impedance. So you place an interposing transformer with appropriate turns ratio so that the impedance seen becomes equal to the characteristic impedance of the cable or the wire or the antenna, whatever you call it. So these are some other applications of the transformer. Of course, in power engineering, the main application is, as I said, you scale up the voltage scale down the current, then you transmit, then when you want to use it, you scale down the voltage, scale up the current and use it. That's the primary application in power engineering. So now if we can actually close this class by finally drawing the transformer equivalent circuit using actually impedances and reactances. So R1 is the for the transformer, R1 is the resistance of the winding one or primary. J omega L1 is the leakage reactance of the primary winding. Then you have the Rm and the J omega Lm, which are the magnetizing impedances. Which is the magnetizing impedances, and Rm is for the hysteresis and the eddy current losses. And then you had the ideal transformer coming in between with a turns ratio of A is to 1, and then we had R2 and L2, for which I will write the reactance of J omega L2, and then a load for which I am just going to write, it could be series RLC network, whatever, which I am just writing it as Z2, or the load here, or if you want, I will load is maybe a better idea to write it as ZL also. I could write it as this, and this becomes the equivalent circuit. So it could be actually load could be anything, you know, it doesn't matter. And you have a voltage source here. There could be a voltage source here also, and it could be a feeding a network. It's okay. You can do that also. So this becomes the equivalent circuit of the transformer. Now what I can do is I can use that A square concept and simplify it. So I'm sorry, I need to copy this. Copy and paste. And what I am going to do is, using that A square factor and referring all the secondary impedances to the primary side, I am going to get rid of this interposing two transformers into ideal transformer and just connect it here. But now I will write it as R2 dash and J omega L2 dash and Z2 dash, where R2 dash is taken as A square times of R2, and let's call this as X2 dash will be taken or leakage. So I'll write it as XL2 dash as A square times of actual XL2. Units are all ohms only, and the load ZL dash is A square times of ZL ohm. Now this is very good, because now the current which is flowing here is phasor I1. I'll write this voltage excitation as phasor V1. This term what you get here, this is V2 dash. Why is it V2 dash? Because it was V2 here, and A times of V2 is the voltage of the secondary referred to primary. So that is a notation used is V2 dash. And this current here I2, when it gets referred to primary, it will be the reciprocal of A and is will be called as I2 dash. And obviously it is slightly different because of the current which is flowing here in the Rm and the J omega XLm. Now, in power engineering, many times this loss, no load, this, if there was no load here, then I2 dash will be 0, and the only prime current which will be flowing would be this, and it would be found out that this current is only about a 1% or 2% of the full load current. So, therefore, for many sim analysis like finding the voltage regulation and so on, many times it is all right as an approximation to ignore this small current which is flowing through this bar, through this branch. So if we ignore that, then our circuit further simplifies to V1, R1, I am deliberately writing R2 dash also here, XL1 and JXL1 and JXL2 dash. So this one is, this thing is neglected. So what happens? This comes in series with this. This comes in series with this. So that's a netting effect which is coming here. And then ZL dash. And this is the current I1. So the R net will be simply R1 plus R2 dash, and the net leakage impedance JXL will be simply JXL1 plus JXL2 dash, and this is my load voltage V, terminal voltage V2 dash, and the voltage regulation will be percentage voltage regulation will be V1 minus V2 dash by V2 dash into 100. So this is the most simplified form of analysis of a transformer and used a lot. That's why I'm sort of putting it here, because it's used a lot. So I think we have covered sufficient amount of ground today. We can stop here for now, and I'll give you some problems on transformer equivalent circuit and regulation later on to solve. With transformers, for measurement of these parameters like Rm, Xm, the net resistance R1 plus R2 dash and XL1 plus X2 dash, not individual leakage reactances, but the net net reactances, which is J times of XL1 plus J plus of X2 dash. So this can be calculated from what is known as the open circuit test and short circuit test for transformer, and you do it usually in our machines lab also, and I'm going to leave that particular part to you as self reading. So open circuit test and short circuit test of transformers, you should do it as a self reading portion. In the next class, we will start looking at average power, reactive power in the single phase circuits. Thank you.